Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Simon R. Green's Forest Kingdom Saga, Hawk and Fisher. Narrated by Terence Aselford, with performances by Danny Gavigan, Ren Kasey, Christopher Scheeren, James Konicek, Yasmin Tuazon, Eric Messner, Nanette Savard, David Coyne, Michael Glenn, Scott McCormick, Michael John Kasey, Drew Kopas, Richard Rohan, Barbara Pinolini, Jeff Allin, Bobby Aselford, Ken Jackson, Joe Brack, M.B. Van Dorn, Lily Beacon, and Ted Stoddard. Hawk and Fisher, Book 3, The God Killer. They come and they go. There are beings on the street of gods. More and less than human, they inspire worship and adoration, fear and awe, and dreams of endless power. No one knows who or what the beings are. They existed before men built the Street of Gods, and will exist long after the street is nothing more than rubble and lost memories. Some say the beings are distillations of specific realities, abstract concepts given shape and form by human fears or wishes, or simply by the times themselves. Others claim they are simply supernatural creatures, intrusions from other planes of existence. No one knows. They are real and unreal, both and neither. They are beings of power, and the Street of Gods is theirs and theirs alone. They come and they go. Winter took residence early in the city port of Haven, ushered in on blustering winds full of sleet, snow, and bitter cold. Thick blankets of snow lay heavily across the roofs and city walls, and hoarfrost pearled the brickwork. Down in the street, the first of the day's pedestrian traffic struggled through the muddy slush, slipping and sliding and cursing each other through numb lips. The cold wind cut through the thickest furs, and frostbite gnawed savagely at exposed flesh. Winter embraced Haven, honing its cutting edge on the slow-moving and the infirm. It was early in the morning, the sun little more than a bloody promise on the starless night. The street lamps glowed bravely against the dark, islands of amber light in an endless gloom. Ruddy lanterns hung from horses and carts, bobbing like live coals on the night. And trudging through the cold and dark came Hawk and Fisher, husband and wife, captains in the city guard. Somewhere up ahead in the narrow streets and alleyways of the north side lay a dead man. It wasn't clear yet why he was dead. Apparently, the investigating constables were still trying to find some of the pieces. Murder was nothing new in the north side. Every city harbors a dark and cruel side to its nature, and Haven was no different. Haven was a dark city, the rotten apple of the Low Kingdoms. But murder and corruption flourished openly in the north side, fueled by greed, hate, and bitter need. People died there every day for reasons of passion, desperation, or business. Nevertheless, this latest in a line of bloody murders shocked even the hardened North Siders. So the guard sent in Hawk and Fisher. There wasn't much that could shock them. Hawk was tall, dark, but no longer handsome. A series of old scars ran down the right side of his face, and a black silk patch covered his right eye. He wore a long furred jacket and trousers and a heavy black guardsman's cloak. He didn't look like much. He was lean and wiry rather than muscular, and he was beginning to build a stomach. He wore his long dark hair swept back from his forehead and tied with a silver clasp at the nape. He had only just turned 30, but already there were streaks of gray in his hair. One might easily dismiss Hawk as just another bravo, perhaps a little past his prime and going to seed. But there was something about Hawk, something hard and unyielding and almost sinister. People walked quietly around him and were careful to keep their voices calm and reasonable. On his right hip, Hawk carried a short-handled axe instead of a sword. He was very good with an axe. He had lots of practice in his 5 years as a guard. Isabel Fisher walked at Hawk's side, echoing his pace and stance with the naturalness of long companionship. She was tall, easily 6 feet in height, lithely muscular, and her long blonde hair fell to her waist in a single thick plate, weighted at the tip with a polished steel ball. She was in her mid to late 20s, and handsome rather than beautiful. There was a raw-boned harshness to her face that contrasted strongly with her deep blue eyes and generous mouth. Somewhere in the past, something scoured all the human weaknesses out of her, and it showed. Like Hawk, she wore the guard's standard uniform for winter, with a sword at her left hip. Her hand rested comfortably on the pommel. A thin mist hung about the street, though the weather wizards had been trying to clear it for hours. The cold seeped relentlessly into Hawk's bones as he strode along, and he stamped his boots hard into the slush to try to keep some warmth in his feet. His hands were curled into fists inside his gloves, but it didn't seem to be helping much. Hawk hated the cold, hated the way it leached all the warmth and life out of him. And in particular, he hated being out in the cold and the dark at such an ungodly hour of the morning. But this shift paid the best, and he and Fisher needed the money, so... Hawk shrugged irritably, trying to get his cloak to fall more comfortably about him. He hated wearing a cloak. It always got in the way during fights. But braving the winter cold without a cloak was about as sensible as skinny dipping in an alligator pool. You tended to lose important parts of your anatomy. So Hawk wore his cloak and moaned about it a lot. He shrugged his shoulders again and tugged surreptitiously at the cloak's hem. Fisher didn't even look at him.
Leave that cloak alone. It looks fine.
Doesn't feel right. The day's supposed to get warmer anyway. If the mists clear up, I think I might drop the cloak off somewhere and pick it up at the end of the shift.
You'll do no such thing. You know you get colds and flus easily, and I'm not nursing you through another one of those. Whew, a couple of degrees of fever and you'd think you're dying.
Hawk stared straight ahead, pretending he hadn't heard that.
Where is this body we're supposed to look at anyway?
Silver Street. Just down there, on the left. It sounded fairly gruesome. Do you suppose it'll look like the others?
I hope so. I hate to think there was more than one homicidal maniac running around on our patch.
Ugh, I hate maniacs. They never play by the rules. Trying to figure out their motives is enough to drive you crazy.
Hawk smiled slightly, but the smile didn't last long. If this corpse was as bad as the others he'd seen, it wasn't going to be a pretty sight. A guard constable found the first body down by the Devil's Hook, hanging from a lamppost on a rope made from its own intestines. The second body adorned the length of Hawthorne Alley. The killer got inventive with the third victim on Lower Eel Street. The hands had been nailed to a wall. The head was found floating in a water cask. There was no trace of the body's genitals. Hawk and Fisher turned into Silver Street and found a crowd already gathered despite the early hour. Nothing like a good murder to bring out a crowd. Hawk wondered briefly what the hell all these people were doing out on the streets at such an unearthly hour, but he knew better than to ask. They'd only lie. The North Side never slept. There was always somebody ready to make a deal and someone else ready to cheat him. Hawk and Fisher pushed their way through the crowd. Everyone in the North Side knew Hawk and Fisher. Hawk paused briefly at the thick line of blue chalk dust the guard doctor laid down to keep the crowd back.
Once more unto the breach.
He walked quickly over the line. The silver torque at his wrist, his badge of office, protected him from the ward's magic, but the blue line always made him nervous. He once made the mistake of crossing the line on a day he absentmindedly left his torque at home, and the agonizing muscle cramps lasted the best part of an hour. That was why the crowd pushed right up to the edge of the line, but made no move to cross it, thus ensuring the scene of the crime remained intact and the guard doctor had room to work. A guard constable stood by at a respectful distance from the body. His dark red cloak and tunic looked almost garish against the winter snow. He nodded affably to Hawk and Fisher. The doctor worked squatting in the blood-stained snow beside the body, but rose to his feet to nod briefly at the two captains. He was a short, delicate man with pale face and eyes and large, clever hands. His official cloak was too large for him and looked like a hand-me-down, but he wore the standard look of calm assurance all doctors seem to receive along with their diplomas.
I'm glad you're here, Captain Hawk. Captain Fisher, I'm Dr. Jaeger. I haven't had much time with the body yet, but I can tell you this much. The killer didn't use a weapon. He did all this with his bare hands.
Hawk looked at the body and had to fight to keep his face impassive. The arms had been torn out of their sockets. The torso had been ripped open from throat to groin, and the internal organs pulled out and strewn across the bloody snow. The legs had been broken repeatedly. Jagged splinters of bone pierced the tattered skin. There was no sign of the head.
Hell's teeth.
Hawk tried to imagine how much sheer strength was needed to destroy a body so completely, and a disturbing thought came to him.
Doctor, is there any chance this could have been a non-human assailant? Werewolf, vampire, ghoul?
Well, there's no evidence of blood drainage. You can see for yourself how much there is around the body. There's no tooth or claw marks to indicate a shapeshifter. And apart from the missing head, everything's here somewhere. No evidence of feasting. No, Captain, the odds are this is your standard homicidal maniac with a very nasty disposition.
Just great. How long before the forensic sorcerer gets here?
Well, your guess is as good as mine. He's been contacted, but you know how he hates to be dragged from his nice warm bed at this hour of the morning.
All right. We can't wait. The trail will get cold. We'd better use your magic to get things started, Doctor. How much can you do?
Not a lot. When he finally gets here, the forensic sorcerer might be able to recreate the entire killing and show us exactly what happened. The best I can give you is a glimpse of the killer's face.
That's more than we've got from the last three killings.
Yeah, we were lucky with this one. Death couldn't have taken place more than half an hour ago. The chances of divining the face are very good.
Wait a minute. I thought you needed the head for that. So you could see the killer's face in the victim's eyes.
Jaeger smiled condescendingly.
Medical sorcery has progressed far beyond those old superstitions, Captain Fisher.
He knelt down beside the body, grimacing as the bloody slush stained his clothes, and bent over the torso. The fingers of his left hand moved slowly in a complex pattern. Blood gushed suddenly from the neck of the torso, spilling out in a steady stream to form a wide pool. Jaeger gestured abruptly, and the blood stopped flowing. Ripples spread across the pool, as though disturbed by something under the surface. Hawk and Fisher watched, fascinated, as a face slowly formed in the blood. The features were harsh, brooding, and quite distinct. Hawk and Fisher bent forward and studied the face thoroughly, committing it to memory. The image suddenly disappeared, and the blood was only blood again. Hawk and Fisher straightened up, and Jaeger got to his feet again. Hawk nodded appreciatively to him.
Anything else you can do for us?
No, not really. From the pattern of the bloodstains, I don't think the victim had time to struggle much, which suggests that most, if not all, the mutilations took place after death.
Cause of death?
Take your pick. Any one of those injuries would have been enough to kill him.
Hawk gestured for the guard constable to come over and join them. He was a dark, heavyset man in his mid-40s with a 20-year star on his uniform. He had the calm, resigned look of the seasoned guard who'd seen it all before. He glanced briefly at the body as he came to stand beside it, but nothing showed in his face.
Constable Roberts at your service, Captain Hawk, Captain Fisher.
Who found the body?
A couple of kids coming back from a party. Merchants' families. Took a shortcut through the north side on a dare and found a bit more than they bargained for. They're in the house opposite with my partner, having a cup of tea. It's good for shock tea.
They see anything? Apart from the body?
Apparently not, Captain.
We better talk to them anyway. See if you can move that crowd along. The forensic sorcerer should be here soon, and he hates working in front of an audience.
The constable nodded, and Hawk and Fisher headed for the house he'd indicated, stepping around the bloodstains where they could.
You know, it's times like this I seriously think about getting out of this job. You think you've seen every nasty sight and spectacle the North Side can throw at you? And something like this happens. Oh, how can one human being do that to another?
Hawk felt like shrugging, but didn't. It was a serious question.
Drugs? Passion? Possession? Maybe just plain crazy? There are all sorts in the North Side, on their way up or on their way down. If a man's got any darkness in his soul, the North Side will bring it out. Don't take it so personally, Isabel. We've seen worse. Just concentrate on finding the clues that will help us nail the bastard.
The young people who found the body sat in the house, too shocked and disoriented even to think of making a fuss about leaving. They were clearly merchant class by their dress, lower middle by the look of them, and looked distinctly out of place in the dim, smoky kitchen. A motherly washerwoman fussed over them. Another guard constable sat comfortably by the fire, keeping an eye on them. He wore a 10-year star, but looked like he'd spent most of those years indoors. He nodded pleasantly to Hawk and Fisher, but made no move to get up. The two young people looked to be in their early teens, the girl a bit younger than the boy. Hawk drew up a chair opposite them and concentrated his questions on the boy. The girl was half asleep in her chair, worn out by shock and emotional exhaustion.
I'm Captain Hawk of the City Guard. This is my partner, Captain Fisher. What's your name, kid?
Fairfax, sir. Calvin Fairfax.
All right, Calvin. Tell us about finding the body.
We were walking down Wall Street, Belinda and I, when we heard something. Footsteps, like someone running away. Then Belinda saw spots of blood on the ground, leading into the next street. She didn't want to get involved, but I thought we should at least take a look in case someone was injured and needed help. We walked a little way down the street, and that's when we saw the body.
Did you see anyone else in Silver Street?
No, there was no one else there. Belinda screamed, but no one came to help. A few people looked out their windows at us, but they didn't want to get involved. Finally, the guard constables heard her and came to see what was happening.
What time was this?
About 3 o'clock. I heard the tower bell sound the hour not long before. The constables took over once they saw the body. We've been waiting here ever since. We're very late. Our parents will be worried. Can we go now, please?
In a while. The forensic sorcerer will want to see you when he finally gets here. But after that, you're free to go. You'll have to make a statement for the coroner's court, but you can do that anytime. And in future, stay out of the north side. This isn't a safe place to be walking around, especially early in the morning.
Don't worry. I never want to see this place again for the rest of my life. We wouldn't even have come this way if Luther hadn't dared us to walk past the boathouse.
Hawk's ears pricked up. The boathouse. The name rang a faint but very definite bell.
What's so special about the boathouse?
It's supposed to be haunted. People who've seen things. Heard things. We thought it would be a lark.
His mouth twisted sourly.
We thought it would be fun.
Hawk talked reassuringly with him for a while, and then he and Fisher left the house and walked back out to Silver Street. The cold morning air seemed even harsher after the comfortable warmth of the kitchen.
Boathouse. I know that name from somewhere.
You should. It's been mentioned in our briefings for the past 3 nights. There are some indications the place may be haunted. Neighbors have complained of strange lights and sounds, and no one's seen the occupant for days. Since Bode is an alchemist and a sorcerer, no one's taking it too seriously yet. But there's no doubt it's got the neighbors rattled.
Beats me how you can take in all that stuff. It's all I can do to keep my eyes open at the beginning of the shift. I don't really wake up till I've been on the streets an hour.
Don't think I haven't noticed.
Where is this Bode house?
Just down the street and around the corner.
Coincidence?
Could be.
I don't believe in coincidence. I think we'd better take a look, just to be sure.
Might be a good idea to have a word with Constable Roberts first. This is his particular territory. He might know something useful.
Good idea. You're on the ball today, Isabel.
One of us has to be.
As it turned out, Constable Roberts wasn't much help.
Can't tell you anything definite about the house, Captains. I've heard a few things, but there are always rumors with the sorcerer's house. Bode's a quiet enough fellow, lives alone and keeps himself to himself. No one's seen him for a while, but that's not unusual. He often goes off on journeys. Since no one's been actually hurt or threatened, I've just let the place be. Bode wouldn't thank me for sticking my nose into his business, and I'm not getting a sorcerer mad at me for no good reason.
Hawk's mouth tightened, and for a moment he almost said something, but in the end he let it go. Looking out for number one was standard practice in Haven, even amongst the guard, especially amongst the guard.
Yeah, fair enough, Constable. I think we'll take a look anyway. You stay here until the forensic sorcerer gets here, and keep your eyes open. The killer could still be around here somewhere.
He got exact directions to Bode's house from Roberts. The sorcerer's house stood on the end of a row of fairly well-preserved tenements. Not too impressive, but not bad for the area. The window shutters were all firmly closed, and there was no sign of any light. Hawk tried to feel any uneasy atmosphere that might be hanging about the place, but either there wasn't one, or he was so cold by now he couldn't feel it. He took off his right glove and slipped his hand inside his shirt. Hanging around his neck on a silver chain was a carved bone amulet. Standard issue for all guards, the amulet could detect the presence of magic anywhere nearby. He held the amulet firmly in his hand, but the small piece of bone was still and quiet. As far as it was concerned, there was no magic at all in the vicinity, which was unusual, to say the least. A sorcerer's house should be crawling with defensive spells. He took his hand away and quickly pulled his glove back on, flexing his numbed fingers to drive out the cold.
Have you got the suppressor stone?
I thought you'd get around to that. You've been dying to try the thing out, haven't you?
Hawk shrugged innocently. The suppressor stone was the latest bright idea from the Council's Circle of Sorcerers. They weren't standard issue yet, but a number of guards volunteered to try them out. Working the streets of Haven, a guard needed every helpful device available. Theoretically, the suppressor stone could cancel out all magic within its area of influence. In practice, the range was very limited. It misfired as often as it worked, and they still weren't sure about side effects. Hawk couldn't wait to try it out. He loved new gadgets. That was why Fisher carried the stone.
Great big overgrown kid.
Hawk smiled, walked up to the front door, and studied it warily. It looked ordinary enough. There was a fancy brass door knocker, but Hawk didn't try it. Probably booby-trapped. Sorcerers were a suspicious lot. He knelt down suddenly as something caught his eye. Someone used the iron boot scraper recently. There was mud and slush, and a few traces of blood. Hawk was smiling as he straightened up. Sooner or later, they always made a mistake. You just had to be sharp enough to spot it. He looked at Fisher, and she nodded to show she'd seen it, too. They both drew their weapons.
All right. When in doubt, be direct.
He lifted his axe to strike at the door.
Hold it, Hawk. We could be wrong. If by some chance the sorcerer has come home and is just a slow answerer, he's not going to look too kindly on us if we break his door down. And if that isn't him in there, why warn him we're coming? I've got a better way.
She reached into a hidden pocket and pulled out a set of lock picks. She bent over the door lock, fiddled expertly for a few seconds, and then pushed the door quietly ajar. Hawk looked impressed.
You've been practicing.
Never know when it might come in handy.
Hawk pushed the door open, revealing a dark, empty hall. He and Fisher stood where they were, weapons at the ready, studying the hallway.
There's bound to be some kind of security spell to keep strangers out. That's standard with all magic users.
So will it use the stone? That's what it's for.
Not so fast. If I was a sorcerer, I'd put a rider on my security spell, designed to go off if anybody messed with it.
Hawk frowned thoughtfully.
According to the constable, Bode's a fairly low-level sorcerer. Something like that would need more sophisticated magic.
Try the amulet again.
Hawk held the carved bone firmly in his hand, but it was still quiescent. As far as it was concerned, there wasn't any magic in the area. Hawk shook his head impatiently.
We're wasting time. We're going in there now.
Fair enough.
After you.
Oh, my hero.
They walked slowly into the dim hallway, side by side. They paused just inside the doorway, but nothing happened. Hawk found a lamp in a niche in the wall and lit it. The pale golden glow revealed a long, narrow hallway, open but not particularly inviting. The walls were bare, the floorboards dull and unpolished. There was a door to their right, closed, and a stairway straight ahead at the end of the hall. Fisher moved silently over to the door, listened a moment, and then eased it open. Hawk braced himself, axe at the ready. Fisher stepped quickly into the room, sword held out before her. Hawk moved quickly forward, holding up the lamp to light the room. There was no one there. Everything looked perfectly normal. Furniture, carpet, paintings, and tapestries on the walls. Nothing expensive, but comfortable. The two guards went back into the hall. They headed for the stairs.
Something's wrong here. According to the amulet, there's still no sign of any magic. But this house should be saturated with it. At the very least, there should be defensive spells all over the place. Industrial espionage is rife among magic users. There's always someone trying to steal your secrets.
They made their way to the top of the stairs. The sounds they made seemed very loud in the quiet. The lamplight bobbed around them, unable to make much impression on the darkness. The landing at the top of the stairs led off onto a narrow hallway. There were three doors, all firmly closed. Hawk and Fisher stood together, listening. But there was only the quiet.
Can you smell something, Isabel?
Yeah, something. Can't tell what it is or where it's coming from, though.
The nearest door suddenly flew open, slamming back against the passageway wall. Hawk and Fisher moved quickly to stand on guard, weapons at the ready. At first, Hawk thought the figure before them was some kind of beast, and it took him a moment to realize it was a man wrapped in furs. He was barely average height, but bulging with muscles, overdeveloped almost beyond reason. His furs were dark and greasy, covered with filth and dried blood. There was blood on his face and hands. He was grinning widely, his cheeks stretched to near distortion. Even so, Hawk had no trouble recognizing the face Dr. Jaeger had shown him in the pool of blood. The killer was carrying something in his right hand, and Hawk darted a glance at it. It was a severed head, held by the hair. Hawk concentrated on the killer's face. The unnatural smile didn't falter, and the eyes were fixed and wild. His bearing was savage and menacing, but he made no move to attack them. Drugs? Possession? Insanity? Hawk took a firm hold on his axe. He remembered what the killer did to the body in Silver Street with his bare hands.
We're captains in the city guard. You're under arrest.
You can't stop me! I'm the Dark Man! Yeah.
He swung the severed head viciously at Hawk. Hawk stepped aside automatically. The head crashed into the wall and rebounded, leaving a bloody smudge behind it. Fisher stepped forward, her sword held out before her. The Dark Man slapped the blade aside with the flat of his hand and swung the severed head at her. She ducked, and the Dark Man darted back into the room he'd come from. Hawk and Fisher charged in after him, but the room was empty.
Oh, damn! How the hell did he manage that? He was only out of our sight for a second or two.
Place is probably full of sliding panels and secret passageways. He could be anywhere in the house by now.
Or out of it?
No, I don't think so. We've seen his face. He has to silence us, and he knows it. He'll be back. In the meantime, let's take a look around these rooms. Maybe we'll find a clue or something to explain what's going on.
Optimist.
They stood in a small, cozy bedchamber. The bed was empty, but the bedclothes had been pulled back. They felt cold and faintly damp to the touch. A light coat of dust covered the furniture. Hawk and Fisher poked around for a few minutes, but there was nothing significant to be found. They went back out into the hallway, keeping their weapons at the ready. The next room turned out to be some kind of laboratory. There were glass instruments and tubing, earthenware bowls, and stacked vials of chemicals. The room looked neat and undisturbed, but once again there was a layer of dust over everything. At the back of the room sat a simple desk with two drawers. Fisher opened them. Inside, she found nothing but a handful of papers, covered with complex equations that made no sense to either of them. Hawk put them back, and then paused and sniffed the air. The smell seemed somewhat stronger, and he had an uncomfortable suspicion he knew what it was. The third and last room was a study, small, compact, and tidy. Bookshelves covered one wall, packed with leather-bound volumes of varying sizes. A broad, functional desk, its top covered with scattered papers, stood in the center. The smell of death and decay was very strong. A dead man, dressed in sorcerer's black, posed limply in the chair by the desk. He'd been dead for some time. His head bowed forward, his chin resting on his chest.
Well, at least now we know what happened to the sorcerer Bode, and why there's no magic in this place. His protective spells must have collapsed when he died.
I don't think so. Protective spells don't work like that.
They couldn't have been very good spells. They didn't keep the killer out.
Yes. Interesting.
So, how did he die?
Good question. There's no obvious wound.
Hawk put the lamp down on the desk and gingerly took hold of the sorcerer's hair, tilting the head back. When he saw Bode's face, he almost let it drop forward again. The sorcerer had the same face as the Dark Man.
That's not possible. It can't be him. This man's been dead for days.
Hawk nodded and let the head fall forward again.
So what did we just fight? A ghost?
He started to wipe his fingers on his cape and then stopped as he realized what he just said. They looked at each other for a moment.
This house is supposed to be haunted.
Ghosts don't usually try to bash your brains out with a severed head. Not unless it's their own. And they're not usually built like dock workers, either.
Hawk looked back at the body as a thought struck him.
Relax, Isabel. This definitely isn't the Dark Man. The build's all wrong. This guy's about as well-developed as a sparrow. I've seen more muscles on a Leech Street whore.
The face is still the same, though. Maybe they're brothers. Twins.
Too obvious. Nothing's ever simple, where magic users are concerned.
He leaned forward, and steeling himself against the smell, he searched the body carefully for the cause of death. It didn't take him long. There was a narrow puncture wound just under the sternum. Someone had stabbed Bode through the heart. Hawk readjusted the sorcerer's clothing, stood back, and frowned thoughtfully. One thrust, right through the heart. Very professional. Or very lucky. But even so, how had the killer gotten close enough to do it? Even a low-level sorcerer like Bode should have had more than enough magic to deal with a common assassin. Even assuming the killer had somehow gotten past the house's magical defenses. Bode had to have had some defenses, or a rival sorcerer would have wiped him out by now. Sorcery was a very competitive business, particularly in the north side. Maybe Bode knew his killer and invited him in. That would explain a lot, including why the sorcerer had died sitting quietly in his own study.
Hawk, I think you'd better take a look at this.
Hawk looked around. He saw Fisher studying the papers on the desk, flipping through a half dozen sheets, frowning intently. He moved over to join her.
Most of this is routine. Reports on experiments, memos to himself not to forget things, dates, addresses, and stuff like that. But this is something else. It seems Bode had to travel a lot to acquire certain ingredients for his experiments, which meant leaving his house unguarded, apart from the few magical defenses he'd been able to put together. According to this, Bode was a better alchemist than sorcerer, and he knew his defenses wouldn't keep out any really determined sorcerer. Being more than a little paranoid where his work was concerned, he put a lot of thought into protecting his home while he was away. He did think briefly about acquiring a familiar of some kind, but that meant dealing with some very unpleasant beings, most of which were well out of his league. So he made his own familiar. He used his knowledge of sorcery and alchemy to reach inside himself, extract all the hate and rage and violence, and place them inside a homunculus, a duplicate of himself, the Dark Man. The familiar was bound to the house and couldn't leave without Bode's permission. It made an excellent watchdog. Like you said, the North Side brings out the worst in people.
It does explain a lot. Presumably the Dark Man was out of the house when Bode was killed, and it's been running loose ever since, hating and killing because that's all it was ever designed to do. And now there's nothing left to hold it in check.
We're gonna have to kill it, Hawk. We can't reason with something like this.
We've got to find it first, or wait for it to find us. Damn it, what was a low-level sorcerer like Bode doing, messing around with homunculi? Those things are strictly illegal.
This is Haven, remember?
This stuff is heavy, even for the North Side. The creation of a homunculus carries a mandatory death penalty if they catch you. Research into making homunculi has been banned for centuries. In some places, they still hang, draw, and quarter people just for owning books that mention the damn things.
What's so important about homunculi?
Like a great many other things, it all comes down to inheritance and bloodlines. How are you going to keep the family bloodlines pure if exact physical duplicates keep popping up all over the place? Homunculi make a mockery of inheritance laws. On top of that, there's always the possibility of someone important being murdered and then replaced by a duplicate. Not to mention how easy it would be for some sorcerer to create his own army of homunculi and hire it out to anyone with a grudge against the established order.
You've been reading up on this, haven't you?
It wouldn't do you any harm to spend a little time in the guard library. You'd be surprised at some of the stuff they've got there.
Can we get back to Bode's murder? These notes aren't just about his research, you know. I saved the best for last. Take a look at this.
She handed Hawk a sheaf of letters from the desk. He looked quickly through them, his frown gradually deepening. Someone hired Bode to investigate something having to do with the Street of Gods. The details had been left deliberately vague, as though the writer hadn't wanted to commit anything incriminating to paper. Presumably, he and the sorcerer had known what they were talking about at any rate.
Whatever Bode found out, someone didn't want him passing it on.
This is crazy. What was Bode doing messing around on the Street of Gods? They'd have eaten him alive, literally in some cases. I'm starting to get a really bad feeling about this case, Isabel.
Oh, you always say that at the beginning of a case, Hawk.
And I'm usually right.
That's Haven for you.
The door behind them flew open and the Dark Man filled the doorway. Hawk and Fisher spun to face him, weapons at the ready. The Dark Man's hand snapped forward and the severed head flew through the air.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.